Hare Krishna Prabhu. Thank you once again for joining today. So we will continue our discussion on the topic that is quite universal on what is work meant for. So I will give a quick summary if you want to add something, and then we'll continue after that. So in our previous session, we discussed historically evolving conceptions of work, from work is a punishment for fallen humanity to work that was in the Abrahamic text, then to work is meant to be remunerative and creative, as Renaissance thinkers thought, that work itself can be worship, as reformist thinkers thought, to work in the industrialized context is dehumanizing, as communism thought. Then we talked about the Gita's conception, where it discussed about four directions. So work is meant to for remuneration, for sustenance, then contribution to society. So these two are extrinsic results of work. And then intrinsic is work is meant to be in harmonization. It's according to our psychophysical nature, then it gives us innate satisfaction. And then work is meant for connection with the divine, with Krishna. And when the Gita talks about detachment from the fruits of work, it is more that be detached from the small results, the extrinsic results, and so that you can be open to the bigger riches that you can get by developing your consciousness. I concluded the summary by what point did we hear? I concluded by talking about how detachment means we give up the extrinsic results so that we can focus on the open ourselves to the bigger riches that can come in our consciousness. And then you mentioned about a miser is one who holds the wealth and doesn't get anything bigger out of it.
Yeah.
So if somebody holds on to the external result of remuneration, then they cannot get the other enriching returns from work. Were there any other points?
It was not very significant. But today I would like, later, I would like you to address this one important issue. This could be a conception, or from a bhakti point of view, a misconception, which is a very popular saying, it's a very catchy one. The hands that work are more valuable than the lips that pray.
Yes.
So this is a modern, or we can have some kind of connotations or some threads reaching back in ancient past. The direct confrontation between the idea that we know that the hands are like the working organs, the karmendriyas, and the lips, the tongue is more like a gyanendriya. So this is the classic confrontation between doing welfare work, or are you like the compressor of a machine, or the brain which is guiding the body. Now we talk of brain, you don't have any brain, we accuse people, but nobody has seen the brain. So I would like to bring this to the understanding that whether the outward movements of hands and legs is that should be considered actual welfare work, or if somebody is potently and qualified to pray for others. Like I remember this one thing, one lady told Srila Prabhupada that, Swamiji, please pray for me. And Prabhupada's answer was, that's my business. So whether somebody can be a highly productive and a prized kind of member of society, if he just adheres to the lips that pray kind of thing, maybe it will come out organically as we discuss the second two threads of or two parts of our understanding of the concept of work. Yeah.
Yes. So we could say that, it's a very important point which you have made, and I'll see if we can integrate it into what we are discussing. That,
yeah.
So the social contribution that we make through work is more important than some whatever praying or inner growth that we might have. The question is that, are these two necessarily contradictory?
Okay.
You know, one of the things which I have found is, it's called a specious argumentation, or is to create false polarities. False polarities are a typical tool for emotional manipulation. That means, you know, say for example, when a US president wanted to launch a war on the Middle East, he said, if you are not for the war against terror, then you are for terror. Well, not necessarily. You could have valid concerns about a particular way of attacking terror, but that doesn't mean we are supporting terror. So are the two really opposite things? That is it that the people who, the lips that pray are not having hands, are not associated with hands, and the hands don't work at all? And can the hands that work also not be linked to a body with lips that pray?
Yes, yes.
So the two
can, that's the crux of the issue.
Yeah, so the two can go together. And if you look at the Bhagavad Gita's spirituality, it does talk about Mam Anusmara Yudhyacha.
Exactly.
So remember me, which is one way of saying lips that pray. We connected spiritually internally, but do your responsible duty externally. So the hands that work, Arjuna's hands were working in his responsibility as a martial guardian of society. So the two don't have to be separate. In fact, Srila Prabhupada says in one lecture that if you think that that devotees don't do anything, then you have not understood what is devotion. He says the two greatest devotees in the two greatest epics, Arjuna and Hanuman, they were both dynamically engaged. They're so engaged that they even fought a war. So the point is, there might be some people who use praying and religion as an excuse for not doing anything responsible. And such people are basically escapists, and they are not, they're not the recommended way in which people should live. And as far as people who are in the renounced order, at least if you look at Srila Prabhupada's example, he worked harder than most people who were half of his age, what to speak of his age. So, and Srila Prabhupada created a tradition, a vibrant tradition, where even those who are in the renounced order are working not just for their inner realization, but also contributing as much as they can. So, through sharing wisdom and through creating resources for all-round well-being of society. So both can go together. That would be my first point of response. And it is an artificial polarity created just to manipulate people emotionally. You have any thoughts?
Yeah, the first thought which comes to my mind is that the classic definition of a manager is one who relies on efficacy, or a very fast way of doing things, efficient way of doing things. And a leader is one who understands the purpose behind something. So one person put it like this: a manager can rally people to put a ladder against the wall, but it takes a leader to tell them which is the right wall.
Beautiful. Okay.
So just to bring this management kind of example into our concept of work, that whether this work is short-term oriented or long-term oriented, whether it gives people, like as you yesterday said, and now today also you are reminding our viewers that the remunerative aspect of work is just subordinate to the spiritual or the higher aspect. And in today's times, many people are simply brainwashed into thinking that, as they say in sports, silver is not the opposite of gold.
Beautiful.
So.
Okay, just a passing point. I heard that in any kind of competition, the gold medalist is happy, even the bronze medalist is happy. But the silver medalist is miserable. So the bronze medalist, at least I got something. I got another medal. But yeah, the silver medalist is focusing on, oh, what I missed.
So just see how somebody's brains can be manipulated. This is from an actual advertisement produced by one of the world's biggest shoe manufacturers, sports shoe manufacturers. You don't win silver, you lose gold.
My God.
So
what was the point? How was that connected to shoe advertising?
They were saying that use our shoes and then you will win gold. So it was just to exhort people to do their best. So,
okay,
you got silver, that's no consolation. The biggest worry is that you lost gold. So the remunerative thing is either downplayed, or for somebody who is not enlightened, that becomes the main focus. If your work is giving you remuneration, then it is good. And if it is not, but if it is helping you in the other two spiritual aspects, then what is the use of that work, which doesn't give you whatever daily comforts or fulfills your necessities today? So yeah, that was one point which I wanted to. Yesterday I briefly touched upon this thing, but I would like in today's time, because today we are discussing more about the spiritual aspect of work, this thing of you want to enjoy the fruits, Arjuna, only misers kind of harbor this kind of thought. And Krishna then exhorts Arjuna to, this is early third chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, where there is a clear-cut commandment which says that yajna arthat karmano annatra loko ayam karma bandhana. Very simple. Unless you have that as your target, the spiritual aspect, the alternative is bondage here. And yesterday you nicely brought out the aspect of bondage. Maybe you would like to take this to this level now, that how does one immediately understand that I just have two options in life? Yajnyartha karmana anyatra loko ayam karma bandhana.
Okay. The first thought that came in my mind is that the word yajna, it's a very important verse, this one. So yajna, normally we translate it as sacrifice or even as fire sacrifice specifically. We could conceive of yajna in contemporary terms as contribution. When we sacrifice, what are we doing? We are contributing for something bigger than ourselves. And if you consider the subsequent sections, Krishna gives various levels of contributing. He talks about the cosmic cycle, where there's a cooperation between the earthly, the terrestrial and the celestial levels. And we need to play our part by contributing within that cosmic cycle of continuity. So, yajna karma samudbhava, he says, that by doing your work, you maintain the cosmic order. Then later on, he says that karmanaivahi samsiddhan astito janakadaya lokasangraham evapi sampashyan kartum arhati. So you work as a contribution to maintain the social order. So we could say work to maintain the social order, that is contribution at one level. Work to maintain the cosmic order, that's contribution at another level. In the social order, he says, how do you contribute? You are a leading member. Your actions are going to influence others. Yadyad acharati shreshta tatra devetaro janaha. So if you stick to dharma amid difficulty, people will stick to it. If you give up dharma amid difficulty, others will give it up. And then Krishna talks about later, if you are not taking anything from the world, then you are not obligated to contribute to the world. But even then, still contribute to set an example for others.
Yeah.
And ultimately, this various levels of contributing to the world culminates in contributing to the source of all sources, Krishna. So, Swakarmana tam abhyarcha siddhim vindati manava. So, work, if we see, is done with a mood of contribution. If it is not, it will bind us. So now the levels of contribution that different people can do can vary. But if one works only in a self-centered way, as is, if now we all think of what's in it for me, that's natural at one level. But if that is the only thing we are thinking of, and we don't think about anything else, then that is going to be counterproductive. Even at an immediate level, just like if a doctor, while treating a patient, is only thinking of what's in it for me, then the doctor may knowingly complicate the patient's disease or unnecessarily prescribe some tests or whatever. So in that case, what is my contribution is not in it at all. You know, how much can I fleece the patient for money? That kind of selfish work is destructive for society, and from a perspective of karma, it is destructive for the performer also. So loko ayam karma bandhanaha, that means if self-centered gain is the sole purpose of work, then it binds. If we work in a mood of contribution, then it uplifts. It gradually liberates. So this could be one contemporary understanding of this verse. Any thoughts on this?
Okay. So now if, here is a theoretical question, and it is connected with today's situation also. As I see Guardian UK, CNN, Wall Street Journal, and what else did I see in the last 4 or 5 days? All are focusing on one thing, that as soon as the immediate crisis of COVID-19 spreading everywhere, once the curve is flattened, we are going to see massive numbers of people unemployed. Huge. I mean, they're saying it will be comparable to the Great Depression of 1929. So if somebody says, all right, you two are propagating so much about yajnata karma, in today's times, how do I take the next step? Like theoretically, I would like to do something for yajna, in the sense being a contributor. What could be the roadmap for me?
This time when our activities are decreased could be a time for greater self-observation.
Okay.
So self-observation can lead to self-understanding. I talk about this finding what is our contribution in life. I thought about it two different ways. One is that guna karma vibhaga, Shri Krishna says. That what are that our quality and our activity. So in contemporary terminology, maybe this could be put as competence and comfort. If I have the karma to do something, then I am competent at doing it. If somebody is an intellectual, they can speak and memorize and articulate well. They're competent. And if they have the guna to do it, they are comfortable doing it. So guna refers to more of our inner harmonization, and karma refers to our outer contribution. So if we look back at our own life and see what are the things we are competent at and what are the things that we feel comfortable doing, then that can become a pointer for us to understand what we can do, what is the small part of the big world where we can make our contribution. Any thoughts on this? There's another perspective, yeah, but I'll go there later first.
Yeah. I just like to extend a little bit that, so even if the only job prospect for someone is a Walmart employee or a Amazon warehouse manager or somebody who's a ticket collector in Indian Railways or anything, if somebody puts himself or herself in the position that divine help is already assured, the commandment is given that I need to engage my abilities in the service of Yajna by Vishnu, that is Vishnu himself. So if I, as you rightly say, if I observe what are my strengths and say it's a lockdown period or isolation period or whatever, and I use my faculties of contemplation to align myself. I'm using a big word in the sense, you're just kind of willing to serve. You're willing to be present when you are called for. And just like later in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna is telling Arjuna, I have done everything. You be the instrument of this great project. It's not like you need to take the entire cosmic things in your hands. You be the instrument, nimitta matram bhava. And I will help you from within, dadami buddhi yogam tam. I will give you the knowledge from within, whatever is required. I just thought that yesterday we talked about how we can bring this discussion to somebody who's saying that, okay, I didn't have any kind of knowledge before, and now you are telling me that this is how my work can be enjoyable, my work can be comforting, my work can be remunerative, as well as it will harmonize, it will connect me. The last thing you said is connection. So people are looking for that connection. And as I read, I brought that point that the only choice is being unemployed or unhappily employed.
Yeah.
So if you want to avoid that, the Gita gives a very, very usable roadmap.
Yes. There are many economists and other social thinkers are saying that self-employment might become big in the future as the service industry becomes more, and while many of the mechanical jobs, while at one level they are available for people, but many of them may become more and more mechanized or done through automatons or robots or something like that. So more people will have to look inward and come up, manifest their individuality. And okay, what is it that I can contribute? So this could be a good time for self-observation that can prepare us for the global socio-economic changes that may come across the world in future. And for taking that that leap of faith, for making that we could say road change or break from the past, the understanding that the universe is not just a arbitrary or cruel place, but rather the universe is an arena for service, and there is higher help available for us when we strive to serve, that can give us a substantial and essential confidence boost to try to find our place and our purpose in the overall scheme of things. So, should I move forward, or you want to add something on
this?
Yeah,
please move forward.
Okay, so now we talked about the contribution part, which people can do to find the work that they can do in this world. I would like to go back a little bit, and this you started and talked about the hands that pray and the hands that and the lips that pray and the hands that work. At one level, because we live in a world of digital world, to some extent we have become habituated to digital logic, this or that. But quite often real life is this and that. So like you said, that if the lips pray and then the hands work, I'm paraphrasing, then that would be the best work, because
yeah,
we'll be wisely directed. What is that saying, that the lazy intelligent, isn't it? So we could, there is yeah, lazy intelligent, there is a active intelligent, there's the lazy fool and the active fool. So if we try to apply that 4-4 typology over here, we could say a spiritually minded person who contributes to the world. I have grown increasingly fond nowadays of the word spiritual activist. Okay. So we have environmental activists, we have social activists. So a spiritual activist. So a spiritual activist would be a person who is, we could say, a lazy intelligent, as we say, is active, but not just thoughtlessly active, thoughtfully active. And the Gita actually brings this integration of contemplation and action in its conclusion, when it talks about, as we discuss, mamanusmara yudhyacha, or work for me. So that is, so when people make these statements, they may not necessarily be this kind of statement that the hands that work are better than the lips that pray. It might be from a genuine concern also, that there are people who are using religion to escape. So in this fourfold typology, what the Gita recommends is spiritual activism. That means lazy intelligent. They're active, but they are effectively active, like you said. Not just, so they are the leaders. They think and then they act. Where should the ladder be placed? Then if we have, that's one quadrant, if we put this quadrant here, that lazy active, lazy intelligent. Then we have active intelligent. So they could fall as the managers. So they are working, and if they are well directed, they can be very effective. But they may not always be effective themselves. Then we have the lazy fools and the active fools. So some people who use religion as an excuse for avoiding their responsibilities, we could place them in this category, that they are people who are they're lazy, but they're not wise also. They're thinking they are religious, but if all that they are doing is running away from their responsibilities, then if their hands are also not working, because when we serve Krishna, it is with our entire being. In fact, if we consider the prayer which we chant, the Hare Krishna mantra, it is a prayer, please engage me in your service. And engage me in your service means use my hands also in your service. And then the last category would be the active fool. So we could say that if we really make this dichotomy, that the hands that work will never be attached to lips that pray, then we might well end up in that category where people are active fools. And in many ways, the biggest problems in the world are not caused by people who are praying. You might say that they are a part of a problem, that they are not doing anything productive for society. But there are so many people who are doing things which are destructive for society.
Yeah.
And they are quite active. So lazy fools can be, active fools can be very dangerous. And if we are not spiritually, if we are not directed by wisdom, which often comes through a spiritual connection, then our actions can end up creating far more trouble than what we started off thinking we'll solve. The Bhagavatam says, Dukkha Ushadham Tadapi Dukkham. The cure is worse than the disease. So any thoughts on this fourfold classification?
Very interesting way of looking at that. And possibly this kind of logic could have originated when, as you rightly said, people with a desire to avoid work declare themselves as contemplative sages. And as they say that just scratching your head doesn't mean you are thinking.
Oh God.
So although that act could be connected with the process of the brain working.
Okay.
So, but that doesn't mean that just simply scratching your head means there is contemplation going on inside. So just like
usually scratching your head is associated with bewilderment, isn't it? Some way associated with you scratch your head, then your head will start working? Or what is the idea?
Well, it's quite old as the hills. So when people have used this as a way out of doing their duty, and therefore seeing that bad example, this thing could have come up that the hands that work are better than what I'm saying is, if your sense organs, your working sensory organs, hands, legs, if they need to be trained, and if the subtle part, mind, intellect, is more powerful, then a more powerful and a superior quality of training is required for contemplation. So praying is simply not a lip job, not some lip service. It's not just moving of lips and going a bit deeper, not our subject for today, but our acharyas have also said that bhayakshara naam na hoy, the mere syllables do not constitute a prayer. It has to have the heart into it. Of course, in the beginning, all kinds of efforts are rewarded, seen positively. It's like a child's desperate attempts to get up and walk. And Rupa Goswami says that the propensity is there and the potency also is there, but you just have to give some time. So even if, like, I am really attracted to this statement of Prabhupada that praying for the society, everybody, is my business. And sometimes Prabhupada use the word business in the sense of busyness. What are you busy with in your life? So if somebody says that this person is a contemplative sage, and mind you, it is not that easy, because Arjuna seems to be attracted towards the proposal that knowledge and work in devotion are the same. So why not let me just be attracted to the knowledge part? So seeing that the vast majority of people will have to work, which means getting up in the morning, doing your business, morning business, and going to your place of work. It is always, Prabhupada also mentioned this in Ishopanishad, that today's civilization is simply making more and more people unemployed. And if you see today's capitalists, they say that's not my problem. If the consumer wants something at a lesser price, I need to automate, as they say, shape up or ship out. If you don't automate, then I may lose everything. So in essence, those who are guiding the work ethic today, they are clueless. Because unless you automate, there is no way of reducing the cost per unit or whatever. And then you have vast majorities of people whom you just have to pay. And then those who want to work or those who cannot get work. And then there is laziness, there is indolence, there is too much of sleep, there is crime. So the understanding of, even if you just want to contemplate, that's a kind of a higher service. Like, just to be a very crude example, in my childhood, we have a television which had manual buttons. So in the increasing and decreasing of volume, brightness was dependent upon you personally getting up and doing that. And after 10 years or so, we got the remote control TV. So repairing a manual button managed TV is easier than a remote control, because the remote control one is using higher technology.
Okay.
Is it not? So working with your working senses and working with your contemplating senses. So there is one skill or art in having your hands, or training your hands and legs into doing and performing work. But if you just, I'm just saying, I'm looking at prayer as a kind of service to society, and prayer also is a kind of business, and we need to have a few leaders, the best of the brains, and whose work only should be this kind of contemplative prayer, so that they can distribute the benefit of what they have done. And as you also rightly said, Prabhupada, he didn't start a factory, he didn't work in a factory, but he was busy 20 to 21 hours a day. In fact, this was the first thing which demolished a big objection in my mind, that what do sadhus do? I mean, how do they, what work occupies their mindset? And then here Prabhupada is saying, even 24 hours is less, because there's so much to do. So in essence, the point which I wanted to emphasize was that you need a higher specialization if you feel that just contemplation is my vocation.
That's a very beautiful way of looking at it. One contemporary example could be that if you have a big company like Intel or Google, they have their coders and others who have their 9-to-5 jobs, but then they also have some people whom they call as mavericks.
Yes.
So these are brilliant people, but they just need their space. So they don't have any boss to whom they have to report on a daily basis or their progress report, but they're thinking, and they
don't sign musters. They don't have a 9-to-5 timetable.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
But I know one friend of mine who has worked like that. So somebody at the lower level may be very attracted to this kind of job. No muster, come anytime, go anytime. A slight stipulation is every year you have to have 2 research papers accepted in some major conferences. Now that's the real difficult part, isn't it?
Okay, so such people, they might seem to be not doing much, but they could do something which could change the course of the industry. So in that sense, contemplation, if it is not just otherworldly, if contemplation is connected with action, then contemplation can change the course of action in a substantially constructive way. There could be soldiers who are fighting a war, and there could be scientists who are sitting in air-conditioned labs there seemed to be no danger. But in the Manhattan Project, those scientists were working like mad. They're not allowed to go anywhere, not allowed to do anything. And then we're not recommending weapons of mass destruction over here. But that one weapon which they developed, that did more to end the war than all the millions of soldiers who were actually fighting. So, of course, everybody contributed, but that was like a decisive blow that ended. So, we could say that when you're contemplating, it is like a person in goodness and a person in ignorance look very similar externally. Both may be passive. But the person who is in ignorance, a person is passive like physically, and their mind is wandering aimlessly. Whereas the person is in goodness, their mind is traveling purposefully, creatively, and maybe revolutionarily. So prayer could be said to be the tool for making our mind more purposeful. So the mind, instead of wandering aimlessly, starts moving purposefully, and that transformation happens through prayer, through purification. So it is very powerful and empowering in terms of social act, from activism or action also.
Okay. My last point, how much should a evolved transcendentalist who is adept at prayer, how much his or her involvement should be in reducing the distresses caused by work or the absence of work culture in society? Like, how much can he contribute, he or she can contribute, or what is the exact connection? Or do you feel that you do your work here and then you get your spiritual fruits in the hereafter? Or is it there is any interface where you can see what you are doing is right in the here and the now, and you're also paving your way towards spiritual success?
Yes, so I was going to talk about this point, this work. Swakarmanatam abhyarcha siddhim vindati manava. So this is sometimes translated as work is worship. However, what it says is, through your work, worship the Lord. Swakarmanatam abhyarcha. So it's not work is worship, but work as worship. Work in a mood of worship. The work is worship is often used to say that one doesn't have to do any worship at all. Just work, and that itself is your worship.
Or even more dangerously, any kind of work is worship.
Yes.
So even a hard work done by a thief, he has to get up at late night and climb apartments, take a big risk. Is that work also worship? Because there is a lot of risk involved, there is hard work involved. So yeah, that's a very nice point. Work as worship.
So if we consider work as worship, then the idea is we to have that intention and that motivation or that vision to work as worship, one will need some time, quality time invested in worshiping directly. And then we can take that spiritual inspiration and bring it into our work also. And when we do that, now, for different people, how much should be the engagement in the world and how much should be the withdrawal from the world so that they can directly connect with transcendence? So we could say there is a direct spiritual connection and there is a I sometimes talk about this as inclusive spirituality and reclusive spirituality. So there is, all of us need a healthy integration of both. For some people, those who are in the renounced order, maybe their reclusive spirituality is more and the inclusive is less. For those who are more engaged roles in society, the inclusive will be more. But even those who are in inclusive spirituality, they will need to take some time to take to reclusive spirituality. That means maybe visit a temple, study scripture, meditate, pray. And as far as how much a person who is spiritually evolved should try to influence the work culture, I think that is a big opportunity for spiritualists to influence society today, because the current work culture is unsustainable. And even major players in the corporate world are recognizing that. That's why companies like Google and Salesforce and others, they have seminars on mindfulness and work-life balance. And although for them, the bottom line is what matters, they recognize that if our employees are burnt out, they're stressed and they're diseased, then they won't be able to contribute to our bottom line. Rather, their health insurance will take away from our bottom line. So they are looking for ways in which people can work productively, but also work sustainably. And that is where a spiritual vision of work can lead to a greater sense of sustainability. Because if our vision is reduced to only the remuneration, then we get too emotionally fixated on it. And then if my whole sense of self-worth comes from my net worth, if I think that I don't cry, if I don't do this project, then I'm ruined, my life is wasted, then one becomes too emotionally involved to actually perform properly. So it seems that there is a significant balance between, there's a critical balance between being apathetic, being emotionally unengaged, and being emotionally fixated. It's like, even if, say, a cricketer is playing a cricket match and the final over and has to bat very well to win, now the cricketer has to care. So you have to care that you want to win the match and very strongly want to win the match. So the emotions are actually there. But the cricketer cannot be emotional and just play a rash shot. So we want to be emotionally invested, but not, you could say, emotionally fixated or emotionally controlled and emotionally driven solely. So that balance, if a person knows this is a role, this is important for me, but my life is bigger. I have an identity that is bigger. There is a plan and purpose for my life that is bigger. That awareness of the bigger picture is what spirituality provides us. So spirituality helps us expand our consciousness beyond the immediate. And with that expanded consciousness, it's not that we become apathetic about the immediate. We can still be invested in doing our best in the immediate, but we won't be fixated. We won't be overwhelmed by it. And there is a word that is used, I believe, in mindfulness circle. It is detached focus. Detached focus. So not detached in the sense that I don't care, but detached is that I'm not threatened. And focus, of course, is I'm involved, I'm concerned. So spiritualists could help bring that kind of culture into the mainstream, and that will be spiritually uplifting without being materially detrimental in any way. People will perform, but they'll perform sustainably. Any thoughts about this?
Very good. Yeah.
That was a brilliant point about lot of, so you would like to summarize then? Or
no, you summarize.
Okay. So we started by discussing about this dichotomy between the hands that work and the lips that pray. So the point there was that the two can go together. And in fact, when the two go together, that is the best. So we could say management is just the hands that work, but leadership is the hands that work, which are guided with wisdom, and praying is not just otherworldly activity, but praying can calm us and connect us with a higher intelligence, so that we can act effectively in the world. Then we talked about the same thing in this four quadrants of when we pray and work, then we are lazy intelligent. Whereas if somebody prays and doesn't work at all, then they are like lazy fools, and that's not the recommended standard of the Bhagavad Gita at all. So then you raised this point about, okay, if I have to work, how can I find the best work to do, or a work to do in today's changing economic landscape? So I talked about comfort and competence, guna karma, by which we can find out what we can do. And then toward the end, we mentioned about how one's spirituality can be both inclusive and reclusive. That we don't just go away from the world, but we do work factions in the world. And then you raise the question about, should we try to influence the culture today? So should spiritualists try to influence the culture? Yes. That we can work hard, but work sustainably. That can happen if we can see work as worship, not work is worship. That means we see that my work is a service to the divine, but I have a relationship with the divine bigger than this work. So I'm secure in my connection with the divine, and I'm still also concerned that this connection should also be executed effectively. So thus we can have a detached focus, that balance between being driven by emotions and being bereft of emotions is having being emotionally invested at the same time calm. So that kind of calm focus can come through spiritual culture, and that can transform and positively benefit people today. Anything I left out?
No, very nicely covered everything.
So thank you very much. Hare Krishna.